I would like to invite Dr. Parul Sharma.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Rohit, NN team, and each and every person here in the hall to be such an engaging, such an inspiring team for the past 2 days. So Rohit asked me to speak particularly on calculation and centration of multifocal lenses. And the reason I say that and we chose this was, despite the best of technique, despite the best of technology, and despite the best of brains here, we still have some multifocal patients in our OPD, and we are wondering, what did we not do right? An apparently okay IUL, well executed, your patient is still complaining, I have some of these issues, and you know what he says, Doc Saab, maza nahi aaya. And that cordula is what you said, that your patients didn't have the wow effect. So in Hindi, we say, that's what patients say, and we are like, now what? So in toto, the art of mastering multifocal means that you have to look at the patient and the eye in toto. So we start with how to get our emetropia correct. We look at this aberration part of the multifocal, examine the eyes from the cornea to the macula very thoroughly before deciding on which and how to execute further. So let's start with some basic facts here. Now, we are in a very exciting phase because, you know, from the time of the IUL calculation formulas, where it was just about the axial length and cornea, we've moved on to so many factors, so many variables have got added over a period of time. So we are not looking at cornea, just the anterior and posterior surface. We are looking at their asymmetry. We are looking at the irregularity indices. We are taking into account the lens thickness, the retinal thickness, all put together with data analysis has brought us to a stage where we can practically have some very good formulas for almost all kind of patients there. So the effective lens position prediction was the game changer there. We all know the different calculations which we do based on the axial length, and it will be very safe to say that Barrett Universal 2 now is perhaps the most universally accepted for all across universal axial lens, very popular, giving very good results, including Haggis, Hill RBF, and the Melbourne Ken formulas. So for some people, you know, there are people in the delegates, and we had this discussion over lunch, they still don't have optical biometry. I would say that do away with your constant scan. Please always, always use immersion. If you do not own an optical biometry, make friends with somebody. And for your premium IULs, do send your patients to get your scan and look into them to avoid all these erroneous measurements. So I won't go into each point. I'm happy to share my talk with you later, but I just want to highlight few key points where you need to validate and go back to your calculations to get it right every single time. So you would want to validate if your axial length has these variations. For keratometry, just don't bank on one instrument. So you start with your manual K to your auto K to your topographers to your tomographers. Look at all of them in toto, especially if there is a history of keratorefractive, because these are young LASIK eyes which now will come into the cataract, and you'll have more and more of them when you're planning the cataract surgery, especially for irregular ectatic corneas also. When would you want to again validate your intraocular lens power is when there is a difference in both the eyes, extremely long, extremely short eye, and as I said, post-refractive patients. So there is a plethora and an variation of optical biometries out there. Every year, the software is getting enhanced, and you get so much information from all of these that you need to look at that right in the one click, right from your corneal scans to your pupil, to your accommodation, you know, the Q values, the asphericity, you have it all. The challenge earlier was that you couldn't get through dense cataracts or the media opacities, but the swept source OCT has taken that into account as well, and you can get your scans properly. If you do not have an optical biometer, do not despair. Get your readings accurate. Go online. There are these amazing online calculators where you just have to feed your readings and you will have all the comparative formulas on one screen. So be it Barrett's, which is based on Gaussian methodology, eye ray tracing, or Hill RBF, which is the data of a lot of surgical patients based on artificial logarithm. You have your toric calculators online. Some companies have put their online calculators. So it does make your life very easy in predicting. Now, if we look at something like this, if I have my A scan done well, an immersion technique here, and if I have my lens star here, I'm choosing, if I want to do a pan optics trifocal, the Barrett's is giving me this, and I'm not so off in my holiday and SRK2. Of course, I'm not looking at these two because they are not suitable. So you can pretty much be okay with an accurate reading and a well-executed biometry. Similarly here, in hyperopic patients, I'm choosing Barrett and Hoffer Q and getting pretty similar decent results. So whenever you're confused, look into more formulas. Either you take an average or the best two which work best in your hand, you would want to choose the formula then. So this is one situation where you don't want to shed more tears, and Kumar is going to take up some complex cases after that. But just to highlight what is so different in post-refractive cornea is because the earlier formulas made an assumption of the anterior and posterior cornea being symmetrical. Now that's all changed. So once the assumption has changed with your difference in the anterior and posterior curvature of the corneas, your formulas are not going to work well. So you need to be very careful when you decide what to do. And here again, we are looking at these advanced generation formula. And as we discussed today morning, that ACRS online works out the best. So whatever scanning mechanism you have, you pick up your readings from there, go online, put your readings here. You will get a comparative of almost 7-8 formulas here. So look into an average, see what works best for you. Or you can go directly onto the Barrett Roque, which doesn't require the prior history. Also, that's optional, and you are can be pretty much close to where you want to be. One thing which we always forget when we are looking at our scans, and we are repeating again and again in these sessions, especially for multifocals, is the ocular surface. So look into the eye carefully. If there is a dry eye, please make sure that you treat that first. Look at other inflammatory features and treat that, because you know you don't want to have an oh no feeling and not be correct there. If I have an astigmatism less than one, then I would choose it to treat it with the femto LRI. We have a Victor, so less than one diopter, I would place my LRI or arcuate on the steep incisions. If it is more than one diopter, then I would treat it with a toric multifocal IOL. So when we have taken care of the lower order, should we be concerned about the higher order aberrations in the scanning of our patients for multifocal? Yes, because they affect the quality of vision, as we've been talking for the since morning. And why not? We have wavefront enhanced IULs even in multifocal. So when you know that your cornea, for example, has a positive asphericity, positive spherical aberrations, you can choose a negative. So in those patients, to neutralize the net spherical aberrations, I would probably go for a Technis multifocal or a symphony. So know the sources of aberration, take into account all of them. You can use any of these fancy gadgets. Be sure, look into your maps, look into the Q value, look into the spherical aberrations, and choose a lens, as I said, according to the power, so that you know you can get towards net zero. So just simple scan, you look at your higher aberration. If they are less than 0.3, you are good to go. 0.3, 0.4 would be the cutoff for multifocal. Decide, look at the astigmatism. If it's a regular kind of a cornea, then you can go for your toric multifocal IUL. And as I said, that customize your lens according to the spherical aberrations. So eye scan in one chart can let you know multifocal, no multifocal. I don't have an eye trace, but for my premium IUL, I do send my patients to the next door eye center. And as Dr. Shang says, and I love it, he says, no bar chart is a good chart for multifocals. So if I don't have anything major going on here, then I'm good to go for multifocal. And so these are the higher aberrations, which what I'm looking at is more as trefoil and coma. And if I don't find many over there, I'm good to go. Something like this, lot of noise post-RK, is an absolute no-no for multifocal. So this is the choice according to the IUL aberrations that you can make in choosing the lenses. Dr. Devgans gives a very good decision planner where you can choose your lenses according to the preoperative status. Coming to the second part, the centration. Now you have to realize that for a multifocal patient, the centration is very important, because slight decentration also, the patient is looking not through the pupillary axis but through the diffractive rings, and that's going to take down the quality of the vision because of the aberrations there. So what I need to know is, how is my angle alpha? We focus more on alpha in the intraocular lens planning. That's the angle between the center of the limbus where my capsular bag is going to be vis-a-vis the visual axis. This is more in relevance rather than angle kappa. Kappa we use more at the corneal surface, so that's more pertinent to the refractive surgeries. So different kind of scanners will give you angle kappa there. So you have to look into that. This is the lens star, which gives a pupillary offset here, and the IUL master, it gives you in the value of a CW here for your angle kappas. Angle alpha is measured by eye trace. So this is where you look at acceptable limit. They say angle alpha less than 0.5, angle kappa less than 6. So this is a scan, wavefront scan of a patient. We want to choose for multifocal, pretty regular. Not many bars here, not many noise. We think we are good to go. And we look at angle alpha, and you see that it's 0.56. Again, these are not just numbers. There are a lot of people who would still go ahead and do a multifocal 6-7. I think Dr. Ramamurthy mentioned in one of the platforms that he has even done above 8, and his patients have been happy. But I would be cautious and look into this also. Now, we do femtoresis, and it's debatable whether we are getting better centration of our IULs when we do a femtoresis. I have felt, because the femtoresis is done on a live OCT. So when I'm doing my rexis on a live OCT, I'm bang on the visual axis. So in my personal experience, I have felt that the IUL, which I have to nudge a little nasal to get on the visual axis, I don't have to do that much in femtocapsulorexis. So I definitely feel that it has an advantage. Now, that's the on-table advantage, right? Whether it's actually making a difference long-term, we don't know, because, you know, at the end of the surgery, I'm asking the patient to look into the microscope light. I get my optic center bang onto the visual axis. But over a period of time, the IUL is going to take the place in the capsular bag, and it may just go back to its original position. So we really don't know what we achieve at the end of the surgery on how it's going to be long term. Also the contracture of the bag. So you have to keep that into account, but do aim for centration. If you do feel later on that there is a little decentration, you can play around with the pupil. You can bring the pupil down to get rid of the exposed diffractive rings. You can do iridoplasty. So there are various options. If it's really, really off-center, then you have to be mentally prepared to change the lens also. As I said, I cannot emphasize it more or less. This needs to be looked into detail in any multifocal patient. You have to treat the ocular surface. Last but not the least, you have to look at the OCT macula. There may be a slight membrane or a cyst, and that may be the reason of an unhappy patient despite the perfect multifocal that you have planned, right? So to summarize everything, it has to be a critical selection. You have to understand them. The PCOs, we don't wait that long in multifocal. Sometimes an unhappy multifocal, even with the slightest wrinkle in the posterior capsule, can give a lot of aberrations, not feel happy, contrast halo. So you would not wait and yak the patient earlier. Bilateral implant is more in vogue, because with shorter duration, the patient's adaptability is much better, so they are not struggling with one eye and waiting for the other. Prepare them that they have to use, they can use spectacles, you know, and be ready for the IUL exchange. So to summarize, I would say that, multifocal is a combination of an art and science. Art of connecting to the patient. You connect to the patient, you spend more time with him, understand his needs, counsel him better, be prepared to listen to his woes, if any, later on, and then apply science to the best of the knowledge to have a very happy and a successful patient in your OPD. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parul.